So in one of our previous videos, we talked about Shockley-Queisser limit for single junction based solar cell. And this kind of sets a ceiling on what is the maximum efficiency I can get out of my solar cell. And this maximum efficiency turns out to be in the range of 33 to 34%, depending upon whether you use a black body radiation or AM 1.5 kind of spectrum to calculate this efficiency. But let's go into a little more granularity and look, let's care about what is happening to these individual photons in my solar spectrum. So if I look at this individual photons, and let me consider the case of silicon. So silicon has a band gap of 1.12 eV, and all the photons which are converted into electron and hole pair, they are extracted with this maximum energy, which could be equivalent or less than the band gap, or let's say in the best case it's equal to the band gap. So all these photons are essentially extracted with this energy which is equal to the band gap of silicon. Of course, photons which have wavelengths which lie above this cutoff wavelength for silicon. So for this silicon, this cutoff wavelength is somewhere around 1100 nanometer. So all these photons which have, or these part of the spectrum which has wavelength greater than the band gap of silicon, this essentially just leaks through, or this slab of silicon is completely transparent to all these photons. But that is something we already know. But you know, I'm concerned about these photons which have energy which is higher, or you know, which have wavelength which is lower than this cutoff frequency. So let's consider the case of this photon which has a wavelength of, let's say, 500 nanometer. So the energy associated with this photon is given by this equation. So this has a much higher energy as compared to the band gap of silicon. So if I look into more granularity, and if I think about the efficiency of converting this photon into the maximum energy of the electron and hole pair that I'm able to extract. So now this would be essentially given by this divided by the band gap of my silicon. So I see that for all these photons which are located at a much lower wavelength, the energy of this solar conversion process is much lower. In fact, if I think about a photon which is at an even lower wavelength, it would have even higher energy, and it would have even lower efficiency of converting this photon into electron and hole pair. So first you know, a thought that comes to my mind is, why not use a material which has a higher band gap? So let's say I use a material which has twice the band gap of silicon. So I'm using this material which has twice the band gap of silicon. So of course it will increase this energy of efficiency of this photon to electron hole pair conversion for all these photons which are located at lower wavelengths or higher energy. But in the process, I'll essentially lose out, or I'll lose out all these all this part of the spectrum which lies at wavelengths which are essentially greater than the new cutoff wavelength, which would now be half of what was the case for silicon. So you see this paradox. If I'm using a material with a higher and higher band gap, I'm able to convert these higher energy photons into electron and hole pairs, which are higher energy. But at the same time, I'm losing a larger part of the spectrum, which corresponds to wavelengths which have energy lower than the band gap of this newer material. So to solve that conundrum, the idea that is used, or the concept that is used, is to use multiple of these junctions. So now what I can do is I can split my spectrum in this way. So I've split my spectrum into these three blue and green and red. So these lower energy photons are what belong in this red spectrum. The medium energy photons are what belong in this green spectrum, and the highest energy, which is the lowest wavelength of photons, they belong in this blue spectrum. And now what I do is I absorb this blue spectrum using a higher band gap material, and then I absorb this green spectrum using this intermediate band gap material, and I absorb this red spectrum further using the lowest band gap material. So what I've done by doing or using these three materials, or these three junctions, is having, instead of having one cutoff wavelength, I now have three cutoff wavelengths. One cutoff wavelength corresponding to the band gap of this blue material, then another cutoff wavelength corresponding to the band gap of this green material, and yet another cutoff wavelength corresponding to the band gap of this red material. So if I think of a photon which is located right at this cutoff wavelength for the blue material, it is now converted into electron and hole pair at a conversion efficiency of 100%. Similarly, this another photon which is located at this cutoff wavelength of the green material, it's also converted into electron and hole pair with the conversion efficiency of 100%. Similarly, that is true for this wavelength which is located at the cutoff frequency of this red material. So instead of having that single triangle which was determining my conversion efficiency of photon to electron and hole pair, now essentially I have this three triangle, one corresponding to here, another one corresponding to the screen material, and another one corresponding to this blue material. So there are more than one ways I can achieve this multi-junction configuration. I'm just showing a couple of them over here. So one way I can achieve this multi-junction configuration is to have this what's called as this spectrally sensitive mirrors, or spectrally sensitive filters, which what they do is they take this sunlight, and they in this case they allow all the other components to go through besides this blue component of my sunlight. And that essentially is shown upon this cell one, which would have a band gap which is optimized for converting these high energy photons, and they would be converted into electron and hole pairs over here. The green and the red components are essentially, they pass through this filter, and then there's a second filter over here which filters out the green component, which are then subsequently converted into by this second cell. And then finally, the red components are converted by this third cell. And there might be still some other spectrum which is remaining, which will leak out of this system. Another way to do that would be to place these cells on essentially on one on top of each other, where my highest band gap material would be placed first, and it would absorb all this blue photons. But these green and red photons, they have energy which is less than the band gap of this material. So this material is transparent to them, so they essentially pass through it. And now they are absorbed by this cell number two, which is optimized for optimizing or absorbing this green photons. And finally, you have this third material which can absorb these red photons. And so both these schemes are, can be used to realize this multi-junction configuration, and they achieve efficiency which are higher than what Shockley and Coilier had reported for this single junction cells. In fact, let me, give you some numbers of how high of efficiency we can achieve. So one junction cell can achieve an efficiency of 32% given by this Shockley-Coilier limit. If you think about a two junction cell, it can give you an efficiency of 42%, and these numbers are all reported at a concentration of one sun. If you increase the concentration, these efficiency numbers will go up. Similarly, a three junction cell can give you an efficiency of 48%, and a four junction cell can give you efficiency of 52%. And that brings me to, the topic for the next video, that if I keep on increasing the numbers of this cell, what is the maximum efficiency I can get? So let's say I have a 10 or 12 junction cell, or even let's say I have hundreds of junctions which I'm using. What is the maximum efficiency you can get? And the number turns out to be not 100, unfortunately. It turns out to be close to 85%. And that is something we will discuss in the subsequent videos using a thermodynamic argument. So see you in the next video.